POL, so it's very exciting. Before we get to all the talent here today, we have a few housekeeping things to take care of. First of all, please, please turn off your cell phones and put them away. It needs to be no cell phones in here because it's very disrespectful and it can mess with the microphone. So it's very important that you do that. Also, when the poets are reading their poem, please do not clap until they have completely stopped talking and they step away from the microphone so that we make sure that they're done. The next thing we're going to do is introduce our four judges that we have here today. So I'm going to ask that you hold your applause until we've introduced all four. So the first one that we have is Megan Brumbling, and her work has been awarded the Poetry Foundation's Ruth Lilly Fellowship, the Robert Frost Foundation Award, and many more. And she is the librettist of a new spoken opera, which premiered this May in Portland, Maine, and she reviews theater for the Portland Phoenix and serves as viewers editor for the Cafe Review and teaches at UNE and SMCC. Our second judge is Linda Aldrich, who has published two collections of poetry, one called Foothold in 2008 and another A March in Mad Woman in 2012. And she was a finalist for the Maine Literary Award for Poetry Short Works. And she teaches English at Southern Maine Community College and is the managing editor of Beloit Poetry Journal.
We'd also like to thank Jefferson Nowicki, whose writing has recently been published in many publications, including Cross Border and the Filling Station. He was a 2016 Harbor resident at the Stonington Opera House, and he teaches English at Southern Maine Community College. Lastly, we'd like to thank Rachel Flynn, who has written work winning the Benjamin Saltman Award and the Dorset Prize. She's taught poetry at Northwestern University and Colby College and is the co-editor of the Beloit Poetry Journal. We'd also like to thank our Poetry Out Loud band, Emmy Ruth, Nikki Howard Rogers, and Ethan Hunt. We'd like to thank L Squared for being the mathematical genius behind calculating the scores for today's event. And I'll just give a quick kind of brief overview of how the competition is going to work today. So first we're going to have a round of 8 recitations by all the poets, and then we'll have a short 5-minute stretch break or so. And then please don't leave the YPAC unless it's absolutely necessary during that break. We'll have a second round of 8 recitations by each of the poets of the reciters. And please remember that the judges must be able to hear the recitations, so please hold your applause until the reciter has clearly finished reciting and has stepped away from the mic. And if you need to be excused to use the restroom, please wait until a student has recited his or her poem until leaving or entering the YPAC. So please don't interrupt your poem. And one last check, is everybody's cell phones off? We just don't want to interrupt any of the poets. So thank you. First up, we have Isabel Murray.
Movement Song by Audre Lorde. I have studied the tight curls on the back of your neck moving away from me. Beyond anger or failure, your face in the evening schools of longing, through mornings of wish and ripen. We were always saying goodbye. In the blood, in the bone, over coffee, before dashing for elevators, going in opposite directions, without goodbyes. Do not remember me as a bridge, nor a roof, as the maker of legends, nor as a trapdoor to that world where black and white clericals hang on the edge of beauty in 5 o'clock elevators, twitching their shoulders to avoid other flesh, and now, there is someone to speak for them, moving away from me into tomorrow's morning of wish and ripen. Your goodbye is a promise of lightning in the last angel's hand, unwelcome and warning. The sands have run out against us. We were rewarded by journeys away from each other into desire, into mornings alone where excuse and endurance mingle, conceiving decision. Do not remember me as disaster, nor as the keeper of secrets. I am a fellow rider in the cattle cars, watching you move slowly out of my bed, saying, we cannot waste time. Memory as a Hearing Aid by Tony Hoagland. Somewhere, someone is asking a question, and I stand squinting at the classroom with one hand cupped behind my ear, trying to figure out where that voice is coming from. I might already be an old man attempting to recall the night his hearing got misplaced. Front row center at a battle of the bands where a lot of leather-clad second-rate musicians amped up to dinosaur proportions test drove their equipment through our ears. Each time the drummer threw a tantrum, the guitarist whirled and sprayed us with machine gun riffs as if they wished that they could knock us, quite literally, dead. We called that fun in 1917, when we weren't sure our lives were worth surviving. I'm here to tell you that they were, and that many of us did despite ourselves, though the road from there to here is paved with dead brain cells, parents shocked to silence, and squad cars painting the whole neighborhood the quaking tint and texture of red jelly. Friends, we should have postmarks on our foreheads to show where we have been. We should have pointed ears or polka-dotted skin to show what we were thinking when we hot-rodded over God's front lawn and death kept blinking. But here I stand, an average-looking man staring at a room where someone blonde in braids with a beautiful belief in answers is still asking questions. Through the silence in my dead ear, I can almost hear the future whisper to the past. It says that this is not a test, and everybody passes.
A Display of Mackerel by Mark Doty. They lie in parallel rows, on ice, head to tail, each a foot of luminosity, barred with black bands, which divide the scale's radiant sections like seams of lead in a Tiffany window. Iridescent, watery prismatics. Think abalone, the wildly rainbowed mirror of a soap bubble sphere. Think sun on gasoline. Splendor. And splendor, and not a one in any way distinguished from the other. Nothing about them of individuality. Instead, they're all exact expressions of the one soul, each a perfect fulfillment of heaven's template, mackerel essence. As if, after a lifetime arriving at this enameling, the jewelers made uncountable examples, each as intricate in its oily fabulation as the one before. Suppose we could iridesce like these and lose ourselves entirely in the universe of shimmer. Would you want to be yourself only, unduplicatable, doomed to be lost? They'd prefer, plainly, to be flashing participants, multitudinous. Even now, they seem to be bolting forward, heedless of stasis. They don't care they're dead and nearly frozen, just as, presumably, they didn't care that they were living. All for all. The rainbowed school in its acres of brilliant classrooms in which no verb is singular, or everyone is. How happy they seem, even on ice, to be together, selfless, which is the price of gleaming. Thank you.
Locked House by W.D. Snodgrass. As we drove back, crossing the hill, the house still hidden in the trees, I always thought a fool's fear that it might have caught fire. Someone could have broken in, as if things must have been too good here. Still, we always found it locked tight, safe, and sound. I mentioned that once as a joke. No doubt we spoke of the absurdity to fear some dour god's jealousy of our good fortune. From the farm next door, the neighbors saw no harm came to the things we cared for here. What did we have to fear? Maybe I should have thought. All such things rot. Fall, barns, houses, furniture, we too are stronger than we were apart. We've grown together. Everything we own can burn. We know what counts. Some such idea we said as much. We'd watched friends driven to betray, felt that love drained away. Some self they need. We'd said love like a growth can feed on hate. We turn in and disguise. We warned ourselves that you might despise me. Hate all we both loved best. None of us ever guessed. The house still stands, locked as it stood, untouched a good 2 years after you went. Some things passed in the settlement. Some things slipped away. Enough's left that I come back sometimes. The theft and vandalism were our own. Maybe we should have known.
Television actor with a teary face trying a contact lens. Two muscular victims of industrial accidents. Several vain women. I was one of them. Came Deborah, 4, to pick up her glass eye. It was a long day, Deborah waiting for the blood vessels painted on her iris to dry. Her mother said that, holding Deborah when she was born. First, I inspected her from toes to navel, then stopped at her head. We wondered why the inspection hadn't gone the other way. Looking into her eye was like looking into a volcano. Her vacant pupil went whirling down, down to the foundation of the world. When she was 3 months old, they took it out. She giggled when she went under the anesthetic. 45 minutes later, she came back happy. The gas wore off. She found the hole in her face, you know? It never bled. Stayed happy, even when I went to pieces. She's 5 in June. Deborah, you get right down from there or I'll have to slap. Laughing, Deborah climbed into the lap of one vain lady who had been discontented with her own beauty. Now, she held on to Deborah, looked her steadily in the empty eye. Ecology by Jack Column. Surrounded by bone, surrounded by cells, by rings of hell, by hair. Surrounded by air is a thing, surrounded by silhouette, by honey wet bees, yet skeletons of trees. Surrounded by actual, yes, for practical purposes, people. Surrounded by surreal popcorn, surrounded by the reborn. Surrender in the center to surroundings. Oh, surrender forever, never end her, let her blend around. Surrender to the surroundings that surround the tendo endo surrender, that tumble through the tumbling, to the blue that curls around the crumbling, to that, the blue that rumbles under the sun, bounding the pearl that we walk on, talk on. We can chalk that up to experience, sensing the brown here that's blue now, a drop of water surrounding a cow that's black and white, the warbling black Burnian twitter that's machining midnight orange in the light that's glittering in the light green visible wind. That's the ticket to the tunnel through the thicket that's a cricket's funnel of music to correct and pick it out from under the wing that whirls up over and out. Thank you.
On the back of the wind and floats downstream till the current ends and dips his wing in the orange sun rays and dares to claim the sky. But a bird that stalks down his narrow cage can seldom see through his bars of rage. His wings are clipped and his feet are tied, so he opens his throat to sing. The cage bird sings with a fearful trill of things unknown but longed for still, and his tune is heard on the distant hill, where the caged bird sings of freedom. The free bird thinks of another breeze, and the trade winds soft through the sighing trees, and the fat worms waiting on a dawn bright lawn, and he names the sky his own. But a caged bird stands on the grave of dreams, his shadow shouts on a nightmare scream. His wings are clipped, and his feet are tied, so he opens his throat to sing. Caged bird sings with a fearful trill of things unknown but longed for still, and his tune is heard on the distant hill, where the caged bird sings of freedom. Thank you.
Love Sonnets, number 17, by Pablo Neruda. I don't love you as if you were a rose of salt, topaz, or arrow of carnations that propagate fire. I love you as one loves certain obscure things, secretly between the shadow and the soul. I love you as the plant that doesn't bloom, but carries the light of those flowers hidden within itself. And thanks to your love, the tight aroma that arose from the earth lives to me in my body. I love you without knowing how, or when, or from where. I love you directly without problems or pride. I love you like this because I don't know any other way to love, except in this form in which I am not, nor are you. So close that your hand upon my chest is mine. So close that your eyes close with my dreams. The Legend by Garrett Hongo. In Chicago, it is snowing softly, and a man has just done his wash for the week. He steps into the twilight of early evening carrying a wrinkled shopping bag full of neatly folded clothes. And for a moment, enjoys the feel of warm laundry and crinkled paper, flannel-like against his gloveless hands. There's a Rembrandt glow on his face, a triangle of orange in the hollow of his cheek as a last flash of sunset blazes the storefronts and lit windows of the street. He is Asian, Thai, or Vietnamese, and very skinny, dressed as one of the poor in rumpled suit pants and a plaid macon, sorry. Mackinac, dinghy and too large. He negotiates the slick of ice on the sidewalk by his car, opens the Fairlane's back door, leans to place the laundry in, and turns for an instant towards the flurry of footsteps and cries of pedestrians. As a boy, that's all he was, backs from the corner package store, shooting a pistol, firing it, once at the dumbfounded man who falls forward, grabbing at his chest. A few sounds escape from his mouth, a babbling no one understands, as people surround him, bewildered at his speech. The noises he makes are nothing to them. The boy has gone, lost in the light array of foot traffic, dappling the snow with fresh prints. Tonight, I read about Descartes' grand courage to doubt everything except his own miraculous existence. And I feel so distinct from the wounded man lying on the concrete, I am ashamed. Let the night sky cover him as he dies. Let the weaver girl cross the bridge of heaven and take up his cold hands. Thank you.
Thoughtless Cruelty by Charles Lamb. Fair Robert, you have killed that fly, and should you thousand ages try the life you've taken to supply, you could not do it. You surely must have been devoid of thought and sense to have destroyed a thing which no way you annoyed. You'll one day ruin. 'Twas but a fly, perhaps you'll say, that's born in April, dies in May, that does but just learn to display his wings 1 minute, and the next is vanished quite. A bird devours it in his flight, or come a cold blast in the night, there's no breath in it. The bird but seeks his proper food, and Providence, whose power endued that fly with life when thinks it good, may justly take it. But you have no excuses for it. A life by nature made so short, less reason is that you, for sport, should shorter make it. A fly, a little thing you rate, but Robert, do not estimate a creature's pain by small or great. The greatest being can have but fibers, nerves, and flesh, and these the smallest ones possess, although their frame and structure less escape our seeing. Thank you.
The Man with Night Sweats by Tom Gunn. I wake up cold. I who prospered through dreams of heat wake to their residue, sweat in a clinging sheet. My flesh was its own shield, where it was gashed and healed. I grew as I explored the body I could trust, even while I adored the risk that made robust. A world of wonders in each challenge to the skin. I cannot but be sorry the given shield was cracked, my mind reduced to hurry, my flesh reduced and wrecked. I have to change the bed, but catch myself instead. Stopped upright where I am, hugging my body to me, as if to shield it from the pains that will go through me. As if hands were enough to hold an avalanche off.
Her Head by Joan Murray. Near Iguvukuni in Natal, South Africa, a woman carries water on her head. After a year of drought, when one child in three is at risk of death, she returns from a distant well carrying water on her head. The pumpkins are gone, the tomatoes withered, yet the woman carries water on her head. The cattle crawls are empty, the goats gaunt. No milk now for children. But she is carrying water on her head. The engineers have reversed the river. Those with power can keep their power. But one woman is carrying water on her head. In the homelands where the dusty crowds watch the empty roads for water trucks, one woman trusts herself with treasure and carries water on her head. The sun does not dissuade her, not the dried earth that blows against her as she carries the water on her head. In a huge and dirty pail, with an idle handle resting on a narrow can, this woman is carrying water on her head. This woman who girds her neck with paper clips, this one who carries water on her head, trusts her own head to bring to her people what they need now between life and death. She is carrying them water on her head. Thank you.
Mighty Ponds by Major Jackson. If I told you Earl, the toughest kid on my block in North Philadelphia, bow-legged and ominous, could beat any man or woman in 10 moves playing white, or that he traveled to Yugoslavia to frustrate the bearded masters at the Belgrade Chess Association, you'd think I was given to hyperbole. And if, at dinner time, I took you into the faint light of his Section 8 home, reeking of onions, liver, and gravy, his 6 little brothers fighting on a broken love seat for room in front of a cracked flat screen, one whose diaper sags, it's a wonder it hasn't fallen to his ankle. The walls behind doors exposing the sheetrock, the perfect O of a handle, and the slats of stairs missing where baby boy gets stuck, trying to ascend to a dominion foreign to you and me. With its loud timbales and drums blasting down from the closed room of his cousin, whose mother stands on a corner on the other side of town all times of day and night, except when her relief check arrives at the beginning of the month, you'd get a better picture of Earl's ferocity after school on the board in Mr. Sherman's class, but not necessarily when he stands near you at a downtown bus stop, in a jacket a size too small, hunching his shoulders around his ears as you imagine the checkered squares of his poverty and anger, and pray he does not turn his precise gaze too long in your direction, for fear he blames you and proceeds to take your queen. Thank you.
Don't, by Tony Hoagland. Tell the flowers, they think the sun loves them. The grass is under the same simple-minded impression about the rain, the fog, the dew. And when the wind blows, it feels so good they lose control of themselves and swab-toggle wildly around, bumping accidentally into their slender neighbors. Forgetful little lotus feeders, solar-powered hydroholics, drawing nourishment up through stems into their thin green skin, high on the expensive chemistry of mitochondrial explosion, believing that the dirt loves them, the night, the stars, reaching down a little deeper with their pale albino roots, all Dizzy Gillespie with the utter sufficiency of everything. They don't imagine lawnmowers, the 4 stomachs of the cow, or human beings with boots who stop to marvel at their exquisite flexibility and color. They persist in their soft-headed hallucination of happiness. But please, Don't mention it. Not yet. Tell me, what would you possibly gain from being right?
Sheltered Garden by H.D. I have had enough. I gasp for breath. Every way ends, every road, every footpath leads at last to the hill crest. Then you retrace your steps, or find the same slope on the other side, precipitate. I have had enough. Border pinks, clove pinks, wax lilies, herbs, sweetgrass. Oh, for some sharp swish of a branch. There is no scent of resin in this place. No taste of bark of coarse weeds, aromatic, astringent. Only border on border of scented pinks. Have you seen fruit undercover that wanted light? Pears wadded in cloth, protected from the frost. Melons almost ripe, smothered in straw. Why not let the pears cling to the empty branch? All your coaxing will only make a bitter fruit. Let them cling, ripen of themselves, test their own worth. Nipped, shriveled by the frost, to fall at last but fair with a russet coat. Or the melon, let it bleach yellow in the winter light, even tart to the taste. It is better to taste of frost, the exquisite frost, than of wadding and dead grass. For this beauty, beauty without strength, chokes out life. I want the wind to break, scatter these pink stalks, snap off their spiced heads, swirl them about with dead leaves, spread the paths with twigs, limbs broken off, trail great pine branches, hurled from some far wood right across the melon patch, break pear and quince, leave half trees, torn, twisted, but showing the fight was valiant. Oh, to blot out this garden. To forget, to find a new beauty in some terrible, wind-tortured place.